is your question related? Yeah. Do you want Peter to answer altogether? Do you want to ask your own?
I think it is related, because the way I'm reading the report at 2.7 is that we've presently got £200 million in it. And then at 2.8, in terms of what we're authorising officers to do, would be setting explicit reduction targets. So I'm kind of reading that what Mark Carney was suggesting was that if you do this too quickly, you could destabilise this, you know, the kind of fossil fuel industry. But if we're doing it in this measured and longer term, this is how I'm reading it, so I'd like some confirmation or clarification. I'm reading that we would be doing it in a more measured approach to it, really.
Yes, if I can almost take them in reverse. I think in fairness, in relation to Mark Carney's comments, he was suggesting that if, for example, the conference in Paris suddenly came out with agreements over very substantial increases in carbon costs, then that could destabilise the market. So he was drawing attention to the potential risk of that, although I think the chances of that are fairly remote, just because politicians tend to be fairly pragmatic. In relation to our clean energy investments, yes, we'd be very happy to provide more information on those, and we recognise that we haven't done as good a job as we should have done in some of the positive things that we've done. I think it's impractical to bring a report to the next pensions committee, which is in January, and in fairness, with Christmas ahead of us, we don't have time to undertake the work that would be necessary. But we have a committee in March, and I think it would be very reasonable for us to bring the report to March committee. And I think those steps that we take, particularly in relation to the Montreal Carbon Pledge, would provide more information on the nature of the carbon that the fund has in its portfolio. Because we invest internationally, it sounds like a bit of an excuse, but I wouldn't necessarily recognise coal investments in other countries necessarily, although I might recognise them in the UK and Europe. So I'm sure we can bring more granular information to this committee as well in March.
Is there any more questions, first of all?
Comments on top of that was I appreciate the point you made about the Paris summit and what might come out of that. I think that there's another alternative where maybe the investment community starts to look at fossil fuels in a more kind of risk averse kind of way, because maybe there are positive things happening in the renewable sector. And certainly some fund managers I've certainly read in the press where they feel that, you know, price of oil maybe might not rise again in the future because the cost of renewables is coming down. So it might not necessarily come just from a political angle, it might also come from the investment community itself that starts to see that they're actually, from a long-term perspective, which is obviously what we're particularly concerned about, that these assets are a better investment than traditional fossil fuel assets. And just wants to make a comment on the, I was very disappointed, to be honest, in the LAPFS, we've got a two-page summary there. I thought that was pretty weak in terms of addressing the concerns that I have, because it's all about, you know, engaging positively with companies, that kind of thing. And I would say that if you're not prepared to divest at all, it's a very toothless kind of argument that you can engage positively with the likes of, say, BP or Shell, because their raison d'etre obviously is to maximise the value of their assets. Yeah, I think pension fund holders would not necessarily be totally happy with that approach. If we have a blanket kind of ban on divestment, we have a very kind of weak argument when it comes to engaging, I think, with possibly.
Okay, Peter.
Yeah.
I would agree that I think a blanket ban on divestment isn't necessarily an appropriate thing, and that would be one of the ways in which we best for the most carbon intensive companies within that sector, and consequently more money will go into the companies in that sector that are more carbon efficient. I think in fairness, engagement with companies does encourage them to, for example, people talk about things like carbon capture and sequestration, so that companies that produce carbon dioxide capture that and store it. Unfortunately, one or two companies have already stepped away from that because of the costs of doing it. But by engaging with them, there is the opportunity to encourage them to explore more carbon efficient ways of undertaking the activities that they do. And I think realistically, we know that oil is the building block of a lot of chemical processes. It'll be a long time before we have electric cars. I don't think we'll ever have electric planes, so that there'll always be a requirement for fossil fuels in some way. Although I'm confident too that the technological advances will mean that, as you say, I think the oil price will remain low for a long time because demand for oil has reduced enormously.
I'm not forecasting the price of oil. I'm not doing that. I'm just saying what some people are saying about it.
Okay, so we've asked for our officers to come back to us with a report in March. Just picking up on your comments, Pat, I'm going to go back, because I'm actually a board member of LAMP, so I'm going to go back to LAMP myself. I'm meeting with some of the officers on Monday, and we'll prepare for the March committee an update on engagement with the likes of Shell and BP as well, and see if we can give more information as to what we're doing, because I know that LAF are attending and putting considerable pressure, you know, because jointly the resources of all the pension funds together, it makes for a considerable opportunity to bring about pressure on these companies. So I'll bring a report as well through Peter to that March meeting as well. Are we happy with the recommendations there in the report? Agenda item.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So agenda item 9 is to do. This was the supplementary agenda item to do with appointments of strategic property advisor. This being the company that gives us our advice on our investment in. Property both nationally and I'm hoping in local infrastructure projects for the future. So, Peter, can I let you report on that?
Yes, thank you. The purpose of the report is to recommend the appointment of CVRA capital advisors in respect of the strategic property advisor mandate for Merseyside Pension Fund. Mandates for initial term of 4 years with the option of a further 3 2-year extensions. The contract was previously let in 2010 and it comes to an end at the end of this year. A procurement exercise was undertaken. 60% of the assessment related to qualitative factors, 40% to price. Having undertaken a number of interviews, there were 7 credible responses. And we're very pleased with the quality of the submissions we received. The Exempt Appendix provides information on the value the tenders received, and CVRE both score very highly in relation to quality factors and were the lowest cost tenderer, and they're recommended for appointment to the mandate.
As I say, there is an Exempt Appendices item on this. But in regards to the main body of this agenda item, has anyone got any questions? So there is a recommendation then that we appoint CBRE and the strategic advisor for a period of 4 years with the option to extend for a further 6 years subject to satisfactory reviews. Okay, so happy for that recommendation?
Agreed.
Agenda item 10, which is to do with monitoring of training and gifts of hospitality.
Yes, thank you, Chair. It's important that there's transparency in relation to both training and in relation to gifts and hospitality received by officers of the fund. Every year we bring the reports to this committee. There are two separate appendices. One is in relation to training and CPD, as it's called, continual professional development, and the other is in relation to gifts and hospitality received. Members are asked to note the report. Clearly, happy to answer any questions.
No questions? We're happy with the body of that report, and happy to go with the recommendation and note the report.
Agreed?
Agreed,
yeah. Okay, can I thank the member of the general public for attendance tonight?